Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins. Today on the Best of Ring of Fire, we'll explain how income inequality is literally killing American citizens. We'll also explain how corporations are buying up scientists to hide the dangers of their products, and we'll tell you how the Tea Party might have already lost the 2014 midterm elections for the Republicans. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, you've stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
A few years ago, Exxon made headlines when they began offering thousands of dollars to scientists who are willing to write papers on how climate change wasn't real. Today, corporate money is flowing unrestricted to universities. I have Ring of Fire contributors Joe Cotchett and Mike Burg with me to talk about what corporate money is doing to academic research. Joe, in the last 3 decades, we've seen the numbers skyrocket where we have private industry packing money into university settings so they can create their own tailored kind of research. I think the number has increased 250% just in the last 3 decades. It doesn't bode well for real science, does it?
It does not. Not only that, Mike, we're seeing in academic centers like Boston, the Bay Area, Texas, they are literally surrounding the universities now with, quote, corporate headquarters to influence the product that they're getting out of publicly paid professors. I mean, BP, all the oil companies, but the biggest offender of all is the pharmaceuticals, because the pharmaceutical companies are raping and pillaging medical schools with money to get beneficial reports back on new drugs that they otherwise would never get.
Michael, I know you see this a lot. You handle some of the huge pharmaceutical cases in this country, but one of the easiest stories to follow is the BP story. It is where BP, we have a report come from a university, Stanford University, and it looks like, it actually looks like there is some objectivity to it. And in that report, what we start seeing is that the professor is talking about how there is a new microorganism and the new Berkeley University.
Right.
But the professor is talking about we have a new microorganism and this BP spill is not a big problem. 250 million gallons of oil in the Gulf, 11 people dead, an entire ecosystem destroyed. And this professor from UC Berkeley is trying to defend all that. Give me your take on it.
Well, BP has basically bought their way into both UC Berkeley as well as the University of Illinois. One of the dangers here is they're creating non-science. I think Joe hit it on the head. It's not science. They're making this stuff up. They're trying to use these schools to give us some fake science with propaganda. The scary part, Mike and Joe and the audience out there, is they also are attacking people who are doing real science. We've seen this in big pharma. We've had professors in Harvard, Jerry Ahorn, who's written about it, where he's told that if he's willing to give an honest opinion about what's going on in big pharma, he could not only lose his job, but the school is going to lose their grants. And you combine that with what's going on with the sequester, where $8.7 billion are being taken away from real funding of science, we're all in real trouble here because they're just going to control it.
Joe, isn't the bottom line here, I mean, let's reduce it just common sense. Corporations don't put money in a university unless they expect to get something back. I mean, isn't that just common sense? They don't do this out of the goodness of their heart. They don't do this because they're trying to extract something. That's what we always see, isn't it?
Well, that's the tragedy, and that's the tragic situation that's now developing. The fact of the matter is, I have no problem with corporate America putting money into universities. It's the problem of the quid pro quo. Now, the universities, let's take Stanford, for example, one of our great universities, had tremendous guidelines or very strong guidelines in place as to what could be done with corporate money. In fact, a local newspaper, the San Jose Mercury, found that a third of the faculty at Stanford Medical School had a total conflict of interest when it came to pharmaceuticals. Now, what we have to look at is our national priorities. I don't want to get off into these wars we're fighting, but we're spending $10 billion a month on a couple of wars, Afghanistan and still Iraq. Could you imagine if you took that $10 billion and put it now as we did after World War II, put that back into universities, but the trend is going exactly the other way. And that's the point that Mike raises, that's the point that you raise, and that's what people are seeing out there. As a matter of fact, it goes so far, the professor from Berkeley that came up with this microorganism that was going to eat the oil, so to speak, right away within 30 days. He was criticized by his fellow faculties. By the way, P.S., nothing else happened. He's still around, still professing the integrity of that report.
And by the way, Berkeley never even changed their standards. That's what's important here. For example, Michael, at University of Florida, here in Florida, they take money. They'll take money from a corporation. But they have guidelines. They say, no, you are not going to tell us who to hire. Now, you just go down the road to Florida State University, just right down the highway from there. They took money from the Koch brothers. The Koch brothers had the last decision on who was going to be hired, what the courses that were going to be taught, how the course was going to be taught, what the content of the course was going to be. As a matter of fact, at FSU, this bonehead of a guy in charge there said, yeah, you can come, Mr. Koch, into our university, and you can just tell us what to do. As a matter of fact, 60 people were interviewed that the Kochs did not agree with that didn't get the job to run these various parts of the business school there. 60 people that the Koch brothers said, no, we're going to give you the axe. Now, Michael, here's where this heads. How does it, where's the fine line? What does the university do to protect itself?
Well, you know, the problem is that these universities, they need and want this money. The corporations out there, the Koch brothers, the big pharma, they're out there, they're going to give them the money. We ran into this not only at Florida State, but at some of the finest universities in the country. University of Pennsylvania. We said, we want you to do a study. We want you to do an independent study to determine on a particular drug, and Mike, I'm sure you're familiar with this, as to whether or not it would cause this particular problem. After stringing us along for almost a year, they came back and said, you know, we can't do that because we get so much money from the pharmaceutical industry that to do this independent study may offend them, and therefore we won't do it. This is outrageous. There is no science coming out of this, and there's no money being put in there except from the corporations. Scary.
Joe, what we saw happen, FDR had a great idea. In the 40s, FDR said, listen, we need to get the help from our universities to develop science for health, safety, and welfare of Americans. And we started seeing FDR pump money into universities. At one point, by the 70s, 70% of the money that went through the university came from the government for government research. And then all of a sudden, that's turned upside down. It's completely on its head. Back then in the 70s, only 3% of the money that was going to R&D at universities came from corporate America. How bad has that changed?
Well, it's not only changed dramatically, as you point out, with this sequestration that's now coming. I think the number is somewhere around $6 to $10 billion that universities are going to use next year. However, let me make one further point. What is the motive behind all this? It's not only, as Mike points out, the directing of reports, that is to say, to get favorable ratings, favorable opinions, favorable, quote, scientific reports. What they're also doing is paying universities or donating to universities to give them back a very important product, which is very significant, which are called patents. What they're doing is using university researchers to do all their work and then going to the U.S. Patent Office and claiming that is their patent. And under guidelines that they've now put in place to donate money to, quote, donate, to fund research, small little provisions in there are that anything found and developed will be patented by the donor of the fund of the money. That's a significant, huge problem that universities are now missing out on.
Mike, as far as bias, the British Medical Journal did a really important study in 2010. They found that that a pharmaceutical industry-funded study through university is four times more likely to reflect the bias of the drug company that was doing the study. Now, that's not just limited to pharmaceutical companies. It's also, we saw with BP, the oil industry, you're gonna get the bias there. There's really no other way to control that. I mean, Yale, if you think about it, Yale sent back $20 million to an industry, a corporation that wanted to have too heavy of hand in how they were conducting business. Don't we simply have to say to our university people, you have to draw the line, you have to be bold, or you're going to lose the edge of that intellectual honesty?
Absolutely. Intellectual honesty is where we send our children, and we've gone to universities. The problem you have is that not only, I think four times is an underestimate, to be honest with you. I think it's much greater than that. The other thing we have to be careful about, when you look at Florida State and now we look at Cal Berkeley and University of Illinois, is they're going to pick the professors. And not only are they going to do all the things Joe talked about, but now they're going to be educating the students to their view of thinking of what they believe is the corporate science, the science they're creating. And now we're going to have all these students who are going to be indoctrinated with the corporate mentality that what they're doing is actually honest and true, which it's not. We have to get the universities to say no, a very loud no.
Joe, in about a minute, what we see is the universities, when they're confronted with this, they still give you the illusion that they're in control. That, as a matter of fact, somebody like corporate America gives them that illusion. That's really disheartening, isn't it?
It's not only disheartening, Mike. Nowhere do we see that more than down at Stanford, right in the heart of Silicon Valley, because all of these young entrepreneurs are going over to Stanford University and using students and their research facilities over there in the new world of internet and social communications. It's very dramatic in terms of what they're doing to these young students, as Mike just pointed out. It is a culture that they are now developing. It's not only the Stanfords, it's the little schools all around the country that they are, quote, I hate to use this phrase, but buying
up. Yeah,
they are.
Joe Cotchett, Mike Burg, as usual. Important topic. We're seeing more attention, hopefully, from corporate media on this, but it's a topic we need to continue talking about. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
David, American exceptionalism is looking like less and less of reality as we actually just look at the numbers. You've written about this topic for so long. Of course, you know, it's here in front of us. And to ignore the numbers is just kind of a perpetuation of insanity. What's happening with the inequality issue, and how does that inequality issue affect what we love to talk about where it comes to this concept of American exceptionalism?
Well, America is certainly making itself exceptional, but not perhaps in ways that make much sense. If you look at the level of inequality in this country, it's not like that of Canada or Japan or Australia or New Zealand or Western Europe. It's like Brazil, China, Mexico, Venezuela, Russia. And the gains that are piling up at the top are just stunning. From 2009, that was when the Great Recession officially ended, through 2012. The top 16,000 households, now remember, we live in a country with 160 million households. We're talking about the 1% of the 1%. The top 16,000 households captured one-third of all the increased income in America. And the top 1%, that starts at about $360,000 a year of income, $1,000 a day. They captured 95% of the increased income. And the bottom 90% of Americans, about 280 million of us, average income went down. And it's now down to the level, when you adjust for inflation, of 1966. I was in high school in 1966.
Let's talk about the history of this a little bit. We come out of World War II. And, you know, the interesting thing about World War II is it was a window of opportunity
for America. That window of opportunity was you had industrial nations such as Germany and Italy. You had agricultural nations that were devastated over in the, across the Atlantic. And it's almost like when they bombed the hell out of Dresden, when they leveled Dresden, it was, yes, we're doing this knowing that this is an opportunity for America to capitalize on our industrial complex, to grow when Europe is going to be behind, when Asia is going to be behind. So we had this window of opportunity, it seemed to me, David, and then all of a sudden we abused that window of opportunity. And if what I mean by that is in the abuse process, we created this incredible distinction, this incredible inequality that exists as far as economics in this country. What is your take on that notion?
Well, unquestionably, you know, Dresden, Tokyo, other places, we burned to a cinder and did probably more damage to civilians than we needed to. But I think that was in the cause of winning the war and trying to reduce the number of Allied troops who were killed in the process. But coming out of the war, we continued to have reasonable equality in this country. The change took place in really dates to about 1981 when Ronald Reagan took office. And the several key factors are very clear here. Number one, you can track the worsening fortunes of the vast majority of Americans to the decline in union membership. And in Divided, there's chapters about why unions are important, why unions are market economics, and why conservatives who say they're for market economics should favor unions. They just haven't carefully thought this through. But as unions were cut and cut and cut in this country, the wages went down not just of union members, but of all the people around them. After all, if you're an employer who has a union workforce, you're paying X in wages and benefits and work rules. Another employer may actually pay higher wages just because he doesn't want the work rules. Well, when 37% of private sector workers belong to unions, about 80% of workers benefited. So that's been one of the important things that's happened is the destruction.
Well, the labor for the union movement in America created a middle class. I mean, people listening to this program have heard that time and time again.
And Mike, remember that we required Japan in its constitution to have unions. General Douglas MacArthur, who we all know was a famous liberal firebrand, right?
Right.
He's the one who said, you will have unions because we want you to have a reasonable level of equality, because that will reduce the chance that you will become bellicose.
Okay, so along comes Reagan in 81. Reagan says, gee whiz, you have to trust the billionaires. And if you trust the billionaires, give them more money, give them more tax breaks. The billionaires are going to share all that new wealth with you, that it's going to trickle down. And even back then, you had Stockton, you know, was supporting that. Stockton, as you know, has come out and said, well, now, in retrospect, that was insanity. That was Ronald Reagan's own guy that helped engineer the trickle-down economics. He says it's insanity. He says it's wrong. And I think more importantly, one thing, if you listen carefully what Stockton says, he says you have to, in order for capitalism to maintain itself, you have to have the infusion of money, but you don't. You put the infusion of money at the lower ports of that economy, at the low and at the middle, and then hopefully that moves up rather than putting it all at the top and letting it trickle down. What is your take on how we have taken capitalism out of kilter so badly with this inequality?
Well, what we're practicing is not capitalism in the classic meaning of the word. And trickle-down, a phrase the Democrats invented to denigrate Reagan's terrible policies, it's not trickle-down, it's Amazon up. We are massively redistributing income upward in this country through all sorts of government policies that I've exposed in my earlier books and you and I have talked about in the past, that in subtle ways take a little bit of money from you and hand it over to the super wealthy elite in this country. If you could get a penny a day from everyone in America filtered to you by the government, you at the end of the year would have $1.1 billion. So you don't have to take a lot of money from people to make a handful of people very well off.
And the way we've done that are things such as subsidies. We've done tax breaks. We've done, yes, you can keep your money offshore. We've armed the very top 1% with all of this, these ways to implement this movement of money from the bottom all the way to their pockets, haven't we?
Absolutely. And things like, you know, 2,900 big companies get to tax their workers. That is, the state income taxes that their workers have withheld from their checks don't go to the government. The companies get to keep them. Hundreds of thousands of workers affected by this, particularly in New Jersey, which is the state that does this the most. But 20 states have that. We have industries that by regulation force you to pay a tax that doesn't exist in law that is then kept by the owners of these businesses. And these are all very complicated mechanisms, because inducing this incredible complexity into federal regulation and the tax code, which businesses rail about all the time, is in fact a major source of corporate profits in this country. So the results of that are that the vast majority of Americans don't have the income to buy the goods and services that are needed to make our economy prosper. And why doesn't that change? Well, because the biggest companies, the ones that own 80% of the business assets in America, it's just 2,800 companies own 80% of the business assets in America. They're global companies.
Yeah, and
You can't afford to buy their product. That's just fine. Somebody in Singapore
exactly.
or India will.
David, when we took a break, right before the break, we were talking about what is the nature of what I call the multinational conglomerate, and how are they, you know, it used to be we would talk about the way that the United States would maybe go to South Africa, we'd go to places in Central America, South America, and we would colonize. We'd build little mini empires in those places, and we would extract from the workforce everything we could. We would extract from the natural resources everything we could. We would set up our own little intra-government in any way we could. And then all of a sudden, we would take, and then leave places like South Africa and in Central America and South America. And there was colonization in the truest sense. But now, with the development of these major conglomerates, these international conglomerates, it's almost as if they have said, "Okay, well, let's turn on the United States now." I mean, we don't have countries. We're a multi-conglomerate that may be in Germany, but that doesn't mean we're a German company. I almost equate it as locusts moving around the globe saying, "Well, let's settle down here for a little while." It's almost as if they settled right here. What's your take on that?
Oh, this is exactly what's happening. Instead of capitalism creating wealth, and capitalism over its long history has done a very good job of creating wealth and improving living standards, it's now being turned into a system to mine the economies of the world. It's becoming, in many, many industries, parasitic. And so instead of making broad prosperity, it's sucking the lifeblood out of economies. And
I mean, actually, when you say that's the visual that people miss. We think, okay, well, this is happening because, we don't understand that this new thing, this new invention that's been around a while, but now it's just gotten legs under, this thing called the multinational conglomerate, doesn't have a flag, doesn't have a sense of patriotism anywhere, doesn't have any real contacts anywhere, is given the mission statement of extract, 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 make profits at all cost. This thing now is moving around the globe, and now it's here. And we don't even see that it's come to the United States.
Well, you know, back in the fall of 2001, when the Twin Towers were still smoldering, Ernst & Young, one of the big four accounting firms that operates worldwide, did a webcast for its clients in which one of its partners, Kate Burton, said that this might not seem like the right time to move your corporate headquarters on paper, not in reality, on paper to Bermuda so that you don't pay U.S. income taxes, but profits should trump patriotism. Mm-hmm. These companies have an allegiance, and it's to profits. There is no allegiance to the U.S. Halliburton, the company that Dick Cheney ran, has now moved its corporate headquarters to the Middle East for tax reasons.
But at the same time, David, the thing that I think people fail to focus on, some people may say, well, they have the right to do that. Okay, they have the right to do that.
They have the right
but
to
they
do
use
it.
Our infrastructure. They use our police departments. They use our roads.
Exactly,
they use our
exactly.
military. They use everything they can here, extract everything they can here, and say, we don't have any obligation to pay anything back.
That's exactly the point, Mike, is that they want to have the benefits of being in the U.S., but they do not want to share in the burdens. Mm-hmm. You know, they're the shirker who doesn't want to put his shoulder to the wheel. And that's what we need to recognize, is it's wonderful if you can create a company and create jobs and earn profits because you build a better mousetrap, but you shouldn't be making your profits by getting the taxpayers to provide you with those profits through subsidies and hidden fees and other things. You shouldn't be escaping the burden of supporting the government that makes it possible for you to sell your products and services. And that's what they're doing. They're saying, oh, well, the rest of you should pay. And, you know, there are literally lots of published papers arguing that what we really need to do is eliminate taxes for the very wealthy and make everybody else pay the taxes, because then we'll get more jobs. I think that's the most ridiculous thing imaginable, but there are serious papers making that argument.
Of course there are. Well, okay, so as we watch this develop, I mean, when we really consider that this is a one-way street, that we have this, again, I don't even think of an American corporation anymore. There are very few true American corporations. What we used to call the American corporations built things. They built cars. They built bridges. They built roads. The jobs stayed here. They manufactured things here. That thing that we used to look at has now turned into this multinational conglomerate, and they go to where they can have the jobs done at the lowest price, where they don't have to build anything, where they don't have to pay for anything, where they can extract. And as I look at this, David, and I try to find hope in people that write about these issues, I'm not seeing an end to this. If anything, it seems to be moving at a faster pace than we can even control.
Well, I think that what's happened here is we're no different than the ancients. You know, I teach the law of the ancient world at Syracuse University's Law School and Graduate Business School. And in the ancient world, people would sacrifice virgins and pray to the gods to bring rain so their children wouldn't die of starvation. Well, that's what we're doing to corporations. We're treating them as if they're the gods. We're saying, oh, please, how much money can we give you? How much tax relief can we give you? What can we do so that you will create jobs for us? That's a completely ridiculous approach to this, but that's what we're doing. Instead of having rules that make corporations operate to benefit the society as a whole by sharing in the burdens, by dealing with where they allocate their capital through very simple mechanisms, we are instead saying we will tax ourselves so that you can be richer because somehow this will protect us.
Yeah, and if you're richer, we're all going to be better off. If you're richer,
right,
we're going to be able to buy those things. But the numbers show just we know now, don't we? In other words, we have the history from 81 to today, and the history says that Ronald Reagan was insane. The history says that everybody that supported trickle-down economics was a buffoon. That's what the numbers clearly say. Talk about that. What do the numbers tell us?
In fact, Mike, if Reagan's policies and George W. Bush's policies worked, America today would be absolutely swimming in jobs, and we would be writing stories in the news every day about companies can't find enough workers and wages are going up and there's this broad prosperity instead of all the debt, all the bankruptcy, all of the difficulties we're seeing.
The unemployment,
That's right. These policies do not work. And in fact, look at what you're hearing elites say now. Don't get a college education. You really don't need to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What that does is it
arms those corporations who want to look. The corporation that comes in from Germany, again, they don't live in Germany. They simply have a position there in Germany. They're a multi-conglomerate. They simply come to the America. They want workers without education because they want workers standing in line 10 at a time, because they can tell tell one of them, we want to hire you. The other nine, maybe you want union wages. We can't do that. Maybe you want health care. We're not going to do that. And so, of course, that one person is going to take the job because that's all that's available.
Well, remember also, though, that in the case of Germany, where executives have unions, the VW didn't object to unionizing its workforce in Chattanooga. It was right-wing politicians in America who did. The fundamental problem here is an imbalance. In this new anthology that I edited, Divided, The mm-hmm. Perils of Our Growing Inequality, mm-hmm. to try to get people to understand the broad ramifications of this on public health, on jobs, on your family. One of the people I quote is Plutarch, who said 2,000 years ago that the most fatal ailment, fatal ailment of republics is an imbalance between rich and poor. It doesn't mean you shouldn't have rich and poor. It means you have to have some balance in your economy. And what we're doing is creating not a middle class, but an impoverished class so that we can have this super wealthy class at the top who live off hidden government policies. Maybe hidden is the wrong word, stealthy government policies. Mm-hmm. And until the American people recognize that and begin to elect to office people who grasp these things, who have read their David Stockman, we're going to continue to go down this road. And unfortunately, with the radical Chief Justice of the United States, John Glover Roberts, and his allies on the Supreme Court, we're going to see, I'm afraid, further destruction of unions, further destruction of consumer rights, further
and more empowerment of the corporate
of access,
entity.
Right, yeah. Of access to voting, yeah. And we're going to see corporations elevated in a way that the founders would never believe.
Of course.
The framers of this country created a prototype of collective bargaining in a 1792 law. Mm-hmm. One of the very first laws that our Congress passed required, to get a federal subsidy, contracts between fishermen and ship owners, or you couldn't get a subsidy for the fishing industry.
The recent elections in Virginia were a disaster for the Tea Party, but new restrictive voting laws could prevent a Tea Party upset in 2014. Joining me now to talk about this is attorney David Haynes. David, major changes in Virginia should tell us a lot about what to expect in 2014 if the Democrats play things right. I mean, you know, the Democrats are notorious about losing the game when they're way ahead. Tell us what you take away from that Virginia election.
Well, that's right. There's a lot of positive signs here in this recent election in Virginia for the Democratic Party, which they need to build on. There's also a very important voter suppression issue, which is coming to the fore in Virginia, and is something that we need to the Democrats need to keep their eye on. We've heard about these issues, of course, in the past all over the country. And if you think that they may or may not matter, really, this is an example of an election that under the new law next year, there likely would have been a different outcome. Next year, Virginia will require a photo ID law, which is not the current state of the law. You did require an ID to be present at the polls this year. So that is going to be very different. The Attorney General's election, of course, was very close this year. And with a new law like that coming on the books, basically the Republicans are taking the position that they know who is best to vote. They're not all.
Well, David, they've looked at the empirical data. They know that by way of things like making a voter ID requirement change, by shifting around the polling places, by changing the early voter days, they have all types of scams that they use to try to discourage elderly students, minorities of every kind from voting. We know that that's their plan. They've admitted that that's their plan. And your position is that we're going to see whether it works clearly in Virginia, because the Republicans got trounced in Virginia this time. And the question then becomes, can they adjust to it in a way that's going to make any meaningful difference where they can turn it around? Right now, they're in pretty bad shape up in Virginia. What happened to cause that turnaround? Did people just wake up and say, you know, the teabag party is just so offensive, we just can't be part of it?
Well, that's
what happened.
That's right. You saw it from the beginning when the Republicans decided to hold a convention rather than a primary. This is a move to the far right. You had Cuccinelli, who is the attorney general, who, by the way, did not step down as is customary in Virginia. And that became very important in this election. But the Republicans moved to the right with a convention. You had a lieutenant governor, a candidate by the name of Jackson, who is just so far extreme. His positions are unbelievable. Even the Republican Party would not campaign with him. You had Mark Obenchain, who's from my hometown of Harrisonburg, Virginia, who essentially was a Cuccinelli clone. And so this really was a referendum on the Tea Party in the Commonwealth of Virginia as we go in.
In other words, David, you're saying it was so clear that this is the new Tea Party vehicle, and there was an out-and-out rejection of that Tea Party vehicle. No, from what I understand, the millions of dollars that the Koch brother-type money pushed into Virginia was staggering. And they were there to try to prop up the Tea Party. And it seems like every
At every turn, the voter said no. Now, I was interested in something with this missing ballot box from Richmond. Hopefully, that when this election's over, there's going to be a serious investigation into that, because you can count on one thing: there won't be anything done by the Republicans to look into it. Are the Democrats motivated to take a look to say, what in the hell happened here?
We'll be looking at that very closely. And another point, and you talked about the Republican playbook, what will they be looking for in Virginia? Consider this, and I mentioned that Cuccinelli did not step down as attorney general, as every former attorney general who ran for governor has done in Virginia. AG stands for almost governor in Virginia. Why was that important? When the election came down to certain contests, we had Cuccinelli was contested precincts. Cuccinelli was making the call. They changed the rules on provisional balloting right during the middle of the election, saying that you actually, the provisional balloter had to come down in person for their vote to be counted, rather than a representative to be present, which has always been the tradition in the Commonwealth of Virginia. And at the same time as Cuccinelli was making these decisions, he was sending out fundraising appeals for the Legal Defense Fund for Mark Obenchain as Attorney General. It's a terrible conflict of interest that's present there. So these are the types of things that they're going to be doing.
David, we also saw a division there. Talk about the chamber and Tea Party division that took place.
I mean, right now the Republicans are having beyond an identity crisis, Pat. You have obviously two huge factions within the party. We saw the press coming even as this election approached, the U.S. chamber has decided that they should no longer back the Tea Party after the government shut down. Here you had in Virginia, where the election was expected really to be a stronger victory for McAuliffe, but the gap really narrowed quite a bit. And so now you have a real crisis, identity crisis, which is dividing the Republican Party. The Democrats need to take advantage of that. You had Cuccinelli and Obenchain, who are taking positions on transvaginal probes for abortion. Obenchain had sponsored a bill where every woman who had a miscarriage in their private home had to report that to law enforcement. You have the voter suppression issues that are going on here, where they basically feel that some citizens are not qualified to vote, that they know what's best for you, and that citizens should not be qualified to vote. So we really have Virginia here as an example. We on the other side, with Chris Christie prevailing in New Jersey by a very comfortable margin, obviously not falling in the Tea Party mold. And you have Cuccinelli down here, who was beat by Terry McAuliffe, who had never held elective office before and had, frankly, a lot of business issues and been doing a lot of positive things. So clearly, this is a crisis for the Republican Party that goes all the way up the ranks. They had
And you see Virginia as a microcosm. That's what you've been writing about. And I think probably as I read your writing, you got it right, because, again, it's the Democrats' game to lose in Virginia. And nationally, for that matter, because I think that it is a microcosm of what we can expect in 2014 if the Democrats do what they're supposed to do. David Haynes, my law partner up in Washington, D.C., thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Pat.
The government pays out billions of dollars every year in federal contracts for things like building roads, building bridges, and sewer systems. But the executives in charge of those contracts are using our tax money to pay their employees poverty wages. I'm joined now by attorneys Howard Nations and Kerry Jardine to tell us what's happening. Howard, it looks like American taxpayers are having to pay underwrite really low-paying, low-benefit jobs all over this country that just isn't helping the recession, isn't helping the economy at all.
Very true, Mike. You would think that the biggest cause of the people trying to reach the middle class and their failure to do so would be the low wages at McDonald's or Walmart. But the fact of the matter is that the largest single contingent of workers in the country who are underpaid as a group are those people who are funded by taxpayer dollars of money going to contractors. Taxpayers are fueling inequality. In 2012, there were $446.5 billion paid to contractors that was distributed to 2.2 million workers. Now, we have certain contingencies, which, as they should, engineers, doctors, scientists who work for these contractors who are well paid. But hundreds of billions of dollars go to companies that are paying very low wages. They're paying $12 or less per hour. And at the same time, many companies are paying highly exorbitant salaries to their execs.
Kerry, let me go to you on this. It's not that it's just wrong. It's not that we, you know, it's just morally wrong, ethically wrong, that we should be paying government workers who really keep our infrastructure together in so many ways. It's not just wrong, but it causes harm to the economy, doesn't it? I mean, isn't that kind of one of the principal issues here?
Well, Mike, since the Davis-Bacon Act in 1931, the government has had the responsibility to set the standard for fair labor practices. And when you have low-wage earners, and Howard is right, when you have 560,000 federal workers that are earning poverty-level wages, it absolutely hurts the economy. They have less money to put into the economy. They pay less in taxes. They take more in terms of government benefits. They don't have the ability to move into the middle class. They don't have the ability to buy houses. I mean, it just ripples through the economy.
Right.
And it does. It has a devastating effect on the economy.
Yeah, I mean, isn't the whole idea here, Kerry, that we want to rebuild our middle class? What are some of the, Howard, what are some of the areas that we see this occurring, where we're taking taxpayers' dollars, we're giving it to contractors? In other words, government has just gone crazy with wanting to hire contractors to do virtually everything. So we take this money, we give it to the contractor, and then the contractor is involved in a race to the bottom on how little they can pay the worker. What are some areas we see this?
Well, the areas where we see this are in healthcare. They're in SBA-supported, Small Business Association-supported companies. They're a very large contingent of this comes from federal construction grants, and all the sorts of building maintenance, all the federal buildings that you see, all the federal parks, all those things that have to be maintained. Many of those are maintained through contractors. The private prison system, for example. The government pays the contractor pays the employees. And they're just simply allowing the employees at that level to fall through the cracks.
So, Kerry, if I heard what you said, we do have the Davis-Bacon Act, 1931. The purpose of that was to say, and then we have the executive orders that came after that, and the purpose was to say that we need to have laws that mandate companies that we give as taxpayers, that we give money to, that they're going to at least do something that we can be proud of in taking care of workers. I mean, employment practices, employment standards, ways that we take care of them in retirement, pensions, health care, all of that was contemplated in the 1931 Davis-Bacon Act, but we don't pay any attention to that anymore, do we?
You know, it's been eroded over time. In 1995, Congress came in and started to look at the level of executive pay, and they made some good strides there. But the problem is that the executives for these federal contractors were paid $24 billion in compensation last year alone. And while employing workers, over 500,000 workers that are earning poverty-level wages, the problem is that there's an incentive for the executives to have a workforce that is at the poverty-level wages because more of the money flows into their pockets. And it just creates this continued inequality between the top 1%, the rich, and the low-wage earners. And that's what the Davis-Bacon Act, going back to the Great Depression, coming out of that and during that, they just recognized the government has to be the standard bearer on this. They have to set the example of high labor standards. People that are working for America, building the infrastructure here in America, they need to be earning wages that allow them to move into the middle class. But there seems to be an erosion, Michael. You're absolutely right. There seems to be an erosion on that that's creating some serious problems.
Let's break this down. I mean, you've got a whole spectrum of occupations, as Howard pointed out. You got the military person who sews military uniforms. You've got hospital aides. You've got security guards that are contracted to protect public buildings. You have that food cart worker out at the National Zoo or other places around the country. You have so many things that we don't even think about that are all contracted by private industry, but taxpayers are paying that contractor. And we've almost forgotten the idea that we can say to that contractor, you know what? Part of the bidding process is going to be how you treat your workers. That's going to be part of it. Howard, you mentioned something I'm very interested in. You say that there's been people at the bottom of this process, the person actually doing the day-to-day work, they're not getting paid an awful lot of money, but people at the top are seeing windfalls. How is the CEO pay at the top? How do we gauge and how do we create the amount of money that those people at the very top are getting? They are getting huge windfalls, aren't they?
Well, what happened was the executive order that was entered under President Johnson actually tried to cap executive pay. Unfortunately, they kept it at the high executive salaries, the highest executive salaries in the private sector. You know what's happened to executive salaries in the private sector. They've gone through the roof. Now, the key to this is really that even though they are kept at this level, they're not kept at that being their total income. In other words, the company can pay them anything they want to. The only cap is what the taxpayers, how much the taxpayer money can be used to pay that $750,000 that some of them make.
So in other words, Howard, what you're saying is there was a day when you could have, when a law might have, an executive order might have been relevant to say, look, you can only pay the executive that has a contract for the government. You can only pay that executive a certain scale based on the rest of executives in the business. And when that was done, these executive bonuses weren't, $1 billion, $500 million, some of these ridiculous, outrageous CEO pays that we see now. Overnight, that changed. And now, because of that, a corporation, a subcontractor corporation who's getting taxpayers' money can justify paying that CEO as much as they want, basically, right?
Yes, they can justify paying them as much as they want. But the real key to it is the cap is how much of the executive salary and compensation can be out of taxpayer dollars. So they could lower the cap and the executives could still be paid whatever the company thinks they're worth, but they could put the true cap on the taxpayer dollars. That's what needs to be lowered.
And that's been proposed. I've followed this a little bit. That has actually been proposed by some legislators who say we have to rethink this because the disparity between people at the top and people at the bottom is not just a function of what's happening in the private sector. Now we have government contractors that are doing the same thing, creating a disparity to where the middle class has disappeared. Kerry, what are things we can do? Well, what are things that the U.S. government can do as far as making sure that taxpayer money does help build a middle class by not paying workers Walmart wages if they work for a government contractor?
One of the probably the most common sense approaches to this that hopefully is going to get some pick up speed is capping the executive pay. The President of the United States makes $400,000 a year. All right, the vice president makes $230,000 a year. The average medium income in a household is $50,000 a year. So you bring down the executive pay for federal contract work, as Howard indicated, that doesn't determine the overall executive pay. But if you put a cap on how much can be reimbursed per employee, bring it down from $750,000 down to $230,000, the compensation.
What our vice president is earning,
what you end up doing is you end up increasing the hourly wage to these poverty level workers by $7 an hour, $14,000 a year. You're giving them a chance to buy a house. You're giving them a chance to move into the middle class. And the fact of the matter is, at the executive level, relative to what they're earning, they can give up some of that income to help these low poverty level workers have a chance.
Right, because Kerry, Howard, you mentioned earlier, let me ask you this, Howard. This is something that's not happening in just the low, this is happening in the top tier of government contractors, the people doing technical a government contracting, building jets, building building high ticket items for the government. This is happening all the way to the top, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's happening even in the aerospace industry, for example. But the major problems exist in three areas. In 2012, the federal government spent $30 billion in federal construction contracts. They spent $74 billion in federal infrastructure. And the SBA created 66,000 construction jobs with their loans. But in those three industries, in those three areas alone, there were 80,000 construction jobs where people are being paid less than the $12 per hour. They could address that. Then they could also address the areas like aerospace and the other areas that you're talking about, where even at the high end, the people at the top are making the good money, but they're very few. They're a very small percentage.
Startling numbers, an important, important story. Thanks for joining me, guys.
You're welcome.
The list of crimes being committed by America's biggest banks is almost endless, but the Supreme Court has made it harder and harder for consumers to take these criminals to court. Joining me now to tell us about this is attorney Peter Mugier. Peter, America's legal system, again, protecting Wall Street to the detriment of Main Street. Consumers don't have a chance anymore. This last case that came out where you had class actions, that was the only way for consumers to proceed against Bank of America, the court takes that right away at lower court and at the Supreme Court. Talk about how bad this is for consumers.
It's gotten ridiculous. I mean, if you are a consumer, Main Street consumer, and you have a smaller claim, and I say smaller, I mean, it could be six figures, low six figures. What the courts have effectively done, what Congress has done through legislation, especially on the securities front, is narrow down to where the Main Street does not have redress for a smaller claim. And you've seen
In this case, Bank of America, we knew that they were falsifying documents. They were lying to homeowners about the foreclosure process. They were actually forging signatures dealing with the foreclosure process. They were creating documents that were just, that they simply created out of thin air. We knew they were breaking the law, so people brought a lawsuit against them, and they made it into a class action, and the judge says, no, you can't go forward with a class action. So what does that do to a consumer if the consumer has to handle these one at a time?
If they break out these cases and they force them to bring it one at a time, which is what happened in Bank of America, no matter if they lied, they cheated, they stole, you have evidence of the same, it makes them bring an individual case. And as Pap, as you know, that bringing an individual case over $15, $20, $25, $100,000 against one of these behemoth international companies like Bank of America is almost impossible. The people can't afford it. So essentially what they've done is the door shut on seeking redress for this fraud, because the folks can't afford to bring these size claims against these huge companies like Bank of America.
And what the court is saying, no, every one of the individuals have to bring their own claim. Each claim may cost, if you're going foot to foot against Bank of America, just to get to court could be anywhere around $100,000 per claim just to get to court. And the average claimant with the Bank of America case, they were people who were foreclosed on because they couldn't even pay for their house. How are they going to pay for legal representation in a setting like that? It makes it impossible, doesn't it?
Think about it this way. Let's say there's an expert that you need to prove your case. And in a class case, which just simply means you can bundle all these cases together, you can bring the expert in one time, review the documents, and give the testimony one time. If you have each individual case, mom and pop type homeowner, have to hire that expert in every single case. And it's typically not uncommon for us to spend well into the six figures just on an expert. If you make mom and pop hire that expert in every single case one at a time, you can't get any of the efficiencies, any of the economies, and it effectively bars the Main Street from bringing a case because they can't afford to bring those kind of experts in, that type of firepower that you need to bring a case against Wall Street or against big corporations, because you just can't afford it.
at the Supreme Court level, the conservative, I call them conservative thugs, they're really not even judges. They're simply an extension of corporate America. If you look at Roberts, Alito, Thomas, Scalia, they all come from corporate America. That's where they made all of their money. So now, when they made decisions on, for example, the AT&T case, where you basically left everybody to meaningless arbitration, or the Walmart case, where they said women may not bring cases in discrimination cases because there's simply too many. That was actually the reasoning. When they made decisions like that, they knew that their marching orders, when they sat on the Supreme Court, when they got that appointment, they knew their marching orders from corporate America was to make it difficult for consumers to ever sue big corporations like Bank of America. This is an example right here of exactly how it works, isn't it?
Well, take the AT&T case you mentioned. Essentially what that AT&T versus Concepcion case said is you're forced to arbitration, and if there's a bar in the agreement barring class actions, you can't bring one. So now the Supreme Court said if there's a bar in the arbitration agreement saying you can't bring a class, you can enforce that. So that essentially says as long as fraud is small, it's cheap, because the victims don't have a remedy. They don't have nowhere to go because they can't bring a class, and big Wall Street, big business knows that they can't afford to bring these smaller claims.
So you get to steal from consumers at $10,000 or $20,000 per person, and you can steal as much as you want, because you know, is even if you steal it, A, the government's not going to throw you in jail because the U.S. Justice Department doesn't have any guts. And exactly. Second of all, you don't have to worry about going to court, because in the end, there's not going to be a class action. Individual lawyers are never going to be able to handle individual cases for thousands of people, where you have to pay experts $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 a piece simply to come to court. Peter, this is just a continuation of Wall Street dominating both politics and in the civil justice process in America. And frankly, I'd love to say that I see a possibility of things getting better, but I really don't. Peter Mejay, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thanks for having me.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com, on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and on Facebook. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.